Hello?
Hello, Arthur. This is your mother. Do you remember me?
In October of 1960, a satirical new comedy team using improvised material opened on Broadway and climaxed their brilliant previous successes in nightclubs and on television. Mike Nichols was 29, Elaine May was 28. It was also the end of the team. Nichols quit acting and became both the top Broadway stage director and world-famous film director, pictures like The Graduate, Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. And Elaine May? Well, she didn't give up acting, and she also became a director and a writer, though it took her a great deal longer to get her first movie made, and she has directed only four of them in nearly 20 years. But then, unfortunately, there have been very few women directors in pictures. Lillian Gish tried it once back in 1916 and never again. When asked why not, she said, "It's no job for a lady." Luckily, however, there have been several courageous women in the world who challenged that position, and Elaine May has had probably as turbulent a time in pictures as any of them, yet she's managed to leave the same distinctive, savagely satirical stamp on four very different works. In 1970, Paramount signed her as director and co-star for her own script, A New Leaf. Starring Walter Matthau at his insufferable best as an aging, hopelessly misogynist playboy millionaire who goes broke and decides his only hope is to find a rich woman, marry her, and then kill her. Elaine May cast herself as the heiress.
One couple.
Excuse me.
Do you have any straws?
Straws? No straws.
To buy straws.
During the cutting of the film, May and the studio got into a major argument about the ending, and as often happens, the director, writer, star lost, so she disowned the released version, even though it went on to become one of the year's critical and box office successes. And despite the softened ending, the film does remain an extremely biting satire on the battle of the sexes. The following year, she was signed only to direct a picture. The original screenplay was by Neil Simon from a story by Bruce J. Friedman, The Heartbreak Kid. May cast Charles Grodin in his first starring role and cast her own daughter, newcomer Jeannie Berlin, in the Elaine May part, the poor young woman Grodin woos, marries, then decides to drop on their honeymoon because he meets another woman he likes better. Here he tries to break the news,
you know,
gently.
I mean, everything could be terrific. The world could be singing. And then suddenly for no reason, it's over.
The other woman in the piece was played by the young actress Simon had in mind when he wrote it, in only her second film, Sybil Shepherd.
I said, "You're lying in my spot." Did he say you could sit in my stool?
Of course, at the finish, the Heartbreak Kid isn't really even satisfied with Shepherd either. Although The Heartbreak Kid was a considerable success, 5 years went by before another film of Elaine May's was released, and it almost wasn't. The picture May wrote, Mikey and Nikki, was not a comedy, but rather a tough, dark, unrelenting drama starring John Cassavetes and Peter Falk, both of them exceptional. Cassavetes, playing a small-time gangster who believes he's going to be killed, and Falk as his best, oldest friend whom he calls to help him, one he doesn't actually trust, and, as it turns out, with good reason. Elaine May and the studio fought again on this one, and actually she had to abduct the working copy so the film wouldn't be re-edited. After a couple of years, her version finally was released, but without much promotion. And so it was 10 years later before anyone gave Elaine May a chance to direct again, though during that time she was credited as main screenwriter for Warren Beatty's Heaven Can Wait, and uncredited as main script doctor for Dustin Hoffman's Tootsie. Perhaps as a kind of repayment for her help on these two big hits, the two stars, Beatty and Hoffman, teamed up in 1986 for a picture that May would write and direct. Beatty produced Ishtar, one of the most expensive failures in recent years, but the picture actually is very much in the wickedly satirical Elaine May style. And perhaps the high cost of the film prejudiced the mood for what is, in fact, a painfully funny movie, one of the main jokes being how absurd these two leading men allow themselves to be made. But it's a joke, of course, they're in on, and strangely, it seems to work better on the less grand scale of video. And so, Beatty and Hoffman take their rightful place in Elaine May's deadly gallery of male losers and their hapless females, a uniquely skewed vision of America circa end of 20th century.